forgiveness of our sins, for the times we have failed, may his compassion lift us up and restore our strength. Together we pray. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, who have laid down by your precept of charity that we should sincerely love those who afflict us, grant that we may follow the commands of the new law, striving to return good for evil and bearing one another's burdens. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The birds of the sky will devour him.
unusual about that. Do not the pagans do the same? So, be perfect, just as your heavenly Father is perfect. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In some ways, today's gospel is a comparison and contrast of love, a comparison and contrast of a divine love from our Heavenly Father and a human love that is observable around us or even within our own hearts. So the divine love then shines forth. The human love is what Jesus starts with when he says, "You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy." That really is kind of the experience of most people, not to such extremes of a complete love and sacrifice even for neighbor and for family. Sometimes even that love has its limits within the human experience. And not the extreme of loving our enemies or hating our enemies, to wish ill will on another. But certainly somewhere in the middle there, we have that tendency to love what is familiar and to distrust what is not familiar. So that's where it starts, with a measured kind of love that is encoded even in some of the more human precepts of the Old Testament understanding of the commandments of God. But Jesus says, "I say to you," knowing that he is both human and divine, both man and God, he says, "I say to you, love your enemies." And for this, he pushes it to the extremes of both, even talking about the persecution that is to come. And of course, we know he lived the extremes of both. He loved humanity so much that he emptied himself and took on the form of a slave, that he who was God and without sin took on the flesh of sinfulness so that he could redeem us. And he loved with such a great extent that he handed himself over to a false arrest, to suffer the punishment our sins deserved, to be scourged, carried his cross, and be nailed to that cross for his enemy, for those who had denied him, betrayed him, those who had called for his persecution and death, and us, the very reason in our sinfulness that he embraced that cross. So living out the extremes of both ends, then in the extreme sacrifice of his self-emptying love, and in the extreme witness of his love for his enemies, as he said about his executioners and us, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." He reveals the extremes of divine love. So if human love is encased in the weaknesses of our own nature, divine love is filled with overflowing excess, that he sends the rain to fall on the just and the unjust, that he has the sun rise in all of its glory and beauty and all of the power that it has to sustain our life on the bad and the good. God's love is generous to be given in all directions. So that we can move from that human love closer to the extremes of the divine love, then we stand out as different, unusual, even among our brothers and sisters, unusual in those who are pagans, who believe in other directions or who do not believe at all. And the final result is that we bring that sense of God's presence and the extremes of his love for us into every corner of our lives and in every corner of the world. So today may we then double down on let us turn to him for his grace and power. We pray for the universal church. May the goodness and glory of God's eternal life be witnessed to by the lives and actions of those who call themselves Christian. We pray to the Lord. We pray for our world. May the divisions that we have amongst us come to a sense of being overcome by the union that we share more powerfully. We pray to the Lord. We pray for the sick, the sorrowful, the suffering. May they who are in need of God's healing touch be restored in body, mind, and soul. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear. We pray for those who have gone before us in faith. We remember especially Teresa Herzka. May she and all who sleep in the peace of Christ rise to praise his name forever in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear.
Heavenly Father, we ask that you hear the prayers we have raised and answer them in your wisdom and love through Christ our Lord.
Worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join.
this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Through these mysteries,